Welcome to the Informed Pregnancy and Parenting Podcast. I'm your host, pregnancy-focused chiropractor, Dr. Elliot Berlin. My guest today is an elite certified birth doula, newborn care specialist, elite certified postpartum doula, and owner of Gold Coast Doulas in Grand Rapids, Michigan. She's also co-author of the new book, Supported, Your Guide to Birth and Baby. Kristin Revere, welcome to the podcast.
Thanks for having me, Dr. Berlin. I'm excited to chat with you today.
It's such an honor. And you have so much experience both on the side of being a mom and parent and supporting so many moms and parents. And I want to pick your brain on everything that you know and share some of those pearls of wisdoms that you've picked up along the way with our audience. But let's start at the beginning. Where are you from originally?
I'm from Michigan. I call Grand Rapids home. I was born in the Lansing area and lived out west for part of my childhood, as well as the Pacific Northwest.
You sound a little Michigan-y.
Yes, I do have that Michigan twang.
Yeah.
A bit of the Midwestern draw.
What's winter like in Michigan?
Cold. Although global warming is real, so it's been warmer the last several years than usual, but we get lake effect across Lake Michigan, and it's windy and, you know, black ice and bitter cold most winters.
I mean, if things keep up, it'll soon be the new Southern California.
Exactly, unfortunately.
Sadly. Okay, now you have Gold Coast Doulas. What did you originally plan to do with your life? Because very few people are like, you know what, I think I'm going to be a doula.
That was not in the cards for me. I went to school for journalism and public relations and worked in public relations out of college and loved the excitement of events and working with multiple clients. Also did some political work within that agency. And then I moved on to advertising sales. This will date me, but I did sell Yellow Pages for quite some time.
Like actual Yellow Pages?
Yes.
Not yellowpages.com.
Actual, the phone book.
Wow.
For 8+ years. So Gosh. Yes, it was a blast. I loved it.
I kind of missed those Yellow Pages. It was fun to read through.
Yeah. And I worked with, you know, front cover ads, back cover ads, and every type of business. So as a former journalism major, I loved asking questions. So I learned a lot about many different industries, also sold for magazines and did some radio sales and then transitioned to political fundraising.
Wow. That's a whole different type of sale.
Yes. But yeah, some similarities.
Yeah, similar but different. And I think it's neat to have a profession where you can sort of have different flavors and varieties. It just keeps your mind stimulated in different ways.
Exactly. I get bored easily, so.
Well, now you don't do any of that, right? So how did you go from that to where you are now?
I was working on a governor's race during my first pregnancy and really became fascinated with maternal health and wanted to, you know, have all of the services related to birth and baby at my fingertips, and that didn't exist in my community. So I slowly transitioned to that work. Although my first 3 years of my agency, I did have a full-time job.
So you became interested in it while you were going through it? Like the
through
experience
my pregnancy.
Of,
yeah.
Yeah. And what was missing for you? It sounds like you didn't have what you wanted.
So I had kids later in life. I was pregnant at 36 and 38. And so many of my friends had kids quite some time before I did. So the information that they were giving me was a bit outdated during that time. And I switched providers. I switched from an OB to a nurse midwife, and my midwives recommended a Lamaze class. I wanted to have an unmedicated hospital birth. So as I was looking at taking breastfeeding classes and all the preparation, working on a busy political campaign and traveling state, I found that it was just taking me so long to research. and really wished that an agency existed like Gold Coast Doulas in my area.
So then it sounds like you started to create an agency to fill in the gap for other people, but also be working a corporate job and having a baby.
Yes. So I did not actually get full force into the work until I had my son 2 years after. I started getting into breastfeeding advocacy, creating events, really understanding all of the birth and baby options after my first pregnancy, and then became certified to teach pregnancy and childbirth classes right after my son was born. In fact, I signed up for the class during pregnancy and then went out to the training with my whole family and taught sacred pregnancy classes. And then my students wanted me to be their doula. So I thought, as a hobby, I might take a client here or there, a student that I was especially connected with. And I started working with a doula collective to begin with, where I taught my classes through. And I fell in love with it after the first birth. I was hooked and really loved being able to meet clients where they're at and support families without judgment. And every birth that I attended, I fell more in love with the act of service that a doula provides.
You know, I was a speech and drama major, and I did a lot of journalism in undergraduate. And now that you're saying these things, it does kind of strike me in my mind that having a journalism background probably is helpful for being a doula too, in terms of interviewing somebody about, you know, what it is that they want and what kind of experience they're trying to put together, what their needs are that are or are not being met. I could see how that background would be helpful.
Absolutely. Uncovering what the need is. And as an agency owner, I still take clients myself, but I am the matchmaker for clients and the doulas on my team. So I like to ask a lot of questions in that initial call, whether it's a birth client or a day or overnight postpartum client, to try to find the best fit for the family.
So what are the different services, just broadly, that Gold Coast Doulas offer, both locally and virtually?
Great question. So we locally in West Michigan offer birth doula support, day and overnight postpartum doula support, hypnobirthing classes, a variety of other classes, including breastfeeding, comfort measures, newborn survival. And we also have some virtual services like sleep consulting. We work with clients all over the world. And I have an online course that I co-created with Alyssa Venaclaus called Becoming a Mother that preps for birth and baby. And your video is actually in the course. So thank you very much.
Honored.
And yeah, and then we, as you mentioned earlier, launched a book, and so a birth and baby guide called Supported Your Guide to Birth and Baby. And so, yes, we have a mix of in-person and virtual services. And then my business did expand to Northern and Southwest Michigan for day and overnight postpartum doula support.
Wow. So you have a lot of offerings, both locally and virtually, accessible to anyone, anywhere, some of them. And you have now exposed your wealth of experience and knowledge. So we're going to have to draw some practical tips out of you. Before we do that, let's take a little break. When we come back, I want to find out more in depth about your own experiences with pregnancy, birth, and early parenting. And then we'll come back and pick your brain for useful take-home tidbits. We'll be right back. Welcome back. We're talking to Kristin Revere from Gold Coast Doulas. Okay, you have two kids. You said you started a little bit later, and your experience was that while you were pregnant, you didn't have some of the resources available to you that you were needing, wanting, and hoping for. Tell me from the beginning, so What did you know going in, and what kind of sources of information did you find valuable?
Yes. So again, I interviewed a lot of my friends and watched documentaries. Many of them are on your streaming platform.
We have a lot.
Yes. And read many books, including hypnobirthing. And I am a person who likes to overprepare. And I didn't know what doulas were with my first pregnancy, hired doulas with my second. But I did take Lamont's classes and worked with nurse midwives who gave me a lot of attention and longer appointments than I originally had with the OB that I had worked with my first pregnancy.
So in your first pregnancy, that's when you switched from OB to midwife?
Exactly.
Mid-pregnancy?
Early pregnancy.
And how did you become aware that that's what you wanted to do, or the difference in the model of care?
So I asked friends, and a friend of mine had used this particular midwifery group. So I made some phone calls and they accepted me. It was still early enough in my pregnancy that I was able to easily make a switch and just felt like I was more supported in my wishes for an unmedicated hospital birth with the midwifery model.
Were you more of a natural person to begin with, like, than a medical person?
Absolutely. I had a fear of hospitals at the time and didn't want to feel like a patient, but also due to my age and my husband's comfort level, we felt like the hospital was the best place for us.
Okay, so trying to sort of get the benefits of the medical safety blanket of a hospital without the feelings, especially for you if you have a fear in that setting.
Right.
Without triggering that autonomic reflex where you go into fight or flight mode.
Exactly.
Okay, so then no doula in the first pregnancy?
No doula in the first.
As someone who was over 35, did you feel like your pregnancy was handled differently by the midwives?
Not initially. They had mentioned, because I saw multiple midwives in the practice, that I was having the perfect pregnancy. Although, again, as I mentioned, I was working on the governor's race, so I was traveling quite a bit. My events were at night. I had high stress. But things were going well up until 37 weeks.
What happened there?
I developed preeclampsia.
Ah. What did you notice? What were your symptoms?
I never had a headache, a little bit of swelling, but it was more of the protein in my urine that was.
So you just found it through a routine doctor's visit or midwife
exactly.
visit?
Exactly. Yes. So I wasn't complaining of anything at the time.
So it was a surprise to you?
Yes. And again, as a planner, I didn't love hearing this news when everything was on track through most of my pregnancy. So I was put on modified bed rest.
But you're already 37 weeks, so already in the zone.
Right.
And was it modified bed rest with a plan to monitor or to induce at 39, or what was the goal?
Yes. So monitored, and over time there were more signs. And so it was important to induce. And I did get induced at 39 weeks.
What was the method of induction?
It was a cervical ripener.
Okay. At the hospital?
At the hospital.
Like Cervidil?
Yes, Cervidil.
Okay. What did it feel like for you?
It felt fine for me. I obviously was worried from my Lamaze class hearing about inductions and how that can lead to other interventions that I didn't want, and also certainly didn't want a surgical birth. And so I was worried, and my husband has a daughter from a previous marriage, and she's 22. And his experience was more of that medicalized. She was a surgical birth. So he had more experience in that area than I did. And I had feared even getting an epidural in the needle, you know, in my spine. So I wanted to do whatever I could to avoid. So used a lot of visualization and positive affirmations to get me through that slow time of induction. I should say that my membranes were also swept in the midwife's office before I went into the hospital. And I was, you know, slowly making some progress, but my baby wasn't responding well to the cervidil. And so they took it out and I was contracting, fortunately. And so
just to be clear, they took out the cervidil, not the baby.
Cervidil, yes.
At this point, I would love to pause for a second in your story. This is one of those moments where I feel like you as an individual, but you as a professional, could offer a tidbit for someone, because you're not alone. And a lot of people don't feel comfortable in the hospital. They feel anxiousness about being in a hospital. About, you know, just a tip for someone who knows that they're going to have a baby at the hospital, but they're nervous about it. And I know you mentioned visualizations, but more specifically, what could somebody do in that setting to kind of calm their mind and body down and get all the benefits of being at the hospital without having that intensity in emotion?
So for me, movement was key. Having my husband be there for emotional and physical support. He had our workbook from Lamaze and was trying different positions and hip squeezes. And so, you know, just listening to your body. And if something didn't feel good, or if my baby wasn't responding to a particular position that I was in, then I made changes.
And those things were helpful to you. Okay, going further in your story, so the cervidil baby was not responding. Does that mean like having decelerations in the heart rate, or?
Yes.
Okay, so you took out the cervidil, and what happens next?
So it felt like quite some time had passed, but I'm sure it wasn't. I wasn't looking at the clock, so can't really tell you. But I was having some back labor, and nothing my husband could do was relieving that. So I remembered from Lamaze to try hands and knees. My baby did like that position better. So the nurse walked in and helped me sway my hips. And all of the sudden, I felt like I was pooping. So the midwife ran in, and I was actually crowning at that point. It happened very quickly.
Yeah, sounds super fast.
Yes. And I do remember the midwife telling me as I started pushing that she, because of all the D-cells, had called in the team for a surgical birth, and that I was very fortunate.
Wow. Dodged it.
Yes. Barely. Yeah. My daughter was tiny and it was quick. I remember 3 pushes.
Wow. That's crazy on her first birth. How big?
6 pounds, 2 ounces.
Oh, so no epidural, just kind of what you wanted, an unmedicated birth at the hospital.
Right. No Pitocin, no epidural, no other interventions.
And that's sort of another, I think, misnomer. People feel like if you're going to be induced, you must have an epidural, but that's not exactly true. Like, you could kind of see how it is.
Right.
In your case, things move quickly and you gave birth.
Yeah. So everything was great after delivery until I got to my postpartum room, and I was focusing on breastfeeding and was so excited to room in with my baby. And again, all of those plans of bonding initially after delivery were taken away because my daughter, Abby, had some glucose issues and needed to go to the NICU. So I then started pumping and was going back and forth from my room to the NICU. And she ended up being in the NICU for 4 days.
Oh, wow. That's hard.
Yeah, it certainly put me, I feel like, in a position that I can have a lot of empathy, although I can't relate to families who had their children in the NICU for 6 weeks, for example. Just having some of the feeding struggles and knowing that my plan didn't go as I had prepared for, you know, just allows me to be a better doula.
Right. You can definitely relate to people in a way that someone who hasn't had an experience like that would not be able to. Was the baby just being monitored, or was there some kind of treatment necessary?
So Yes, so obviously the heel pricks, and she was given an IV and then enhanced formula while I was pumping. And while she was still in the NICU, I was able to eventually try to breastfeed her, but I had a limited amount of time that I could do that. And so she eventually was released on that fourth day by her pediatrician. And I went home without my daughter and was back and forth for a bit. And so, yeah, not what I imagined again, but certainly I was thankful that, you know, I was feeling great. I didn't have a surgical birth to recover from. And so I sought help from lactation consultants, both in the hospital and at my home, to be able to meet some of my breastfeeding goals. And I was took a lot of time, but I was successful with that.
Well, congratulations. Thanks. It was a while back, but then you did it again.
Yes. So I had kids back to back. My kids are 21 months apart. And by that time, again, I got involved in the breastfeeding community and different birth and baby organizations. And so I hired doulas right when I found out I was pregnant. And again, due to my age, my midwives had suggested, you know, trying after about a year. And I, even with breastfeeding, still got pregnant quite easily. So I was fortunate in that way.
That's a blessing.
Yes.
Was the second pregnancy different than the first?
Completely different. And so I took Lamaze all over again. So I love to overprepare, as I mentioned. Still read all the books and reviewed the birth partner with my husband. And we went in with wanting to stay home longer, still have a hospital birth, the same midwifery group. And my doulas gave me a lot of reassurance. I was worried about getting preeclampsia again, was worried about my own health, and of course, babies. So at that point, I saw a chiropractor, a Webster certified chiropractor with both pregnancies, but I did see a naturopathic doctor, functional medicine, and did a lot to make sure that I wasn't deficient in minerals and that I was taking care of my health, and used a lot of, again, visualization, positive mindset throughout pregnancy.
And how did you feel? Because a lot of times people say the second pregnancy, especially when they're that close together and you have an infant still, toddler, new toddler, but also your body hasn't had that much of a rest, you know, from pregnancy to birth to postpartum, breastfeeding, pregnant again. Most people say the second one feels more intense and draining than the one before it. But it sounds like you're doing more things to take care of yourself. How did you feel physically, one versus the other?
I felt better the second time around. And I think because I was caring for myself, I was no longer working on political campaigns. So I was doing some consulting and worked for a nonprofit. So yeah, it was quite different during those days than the constant travel and the stress that I had through work.
How did things go at the end? Did you get preeclampsia?
I did not, fortunately. So I had a very easy pregnancy. And the only hiccup was that the midwives in the practice ended up leaving the last month of my pregnancy. So I had an OB deliver, and she, you know, kept with my birth plan, and obviously having worked with midwives was very supportive of my plan. And so there were no health concerns, and my doulas were fantastic and very reassuring. And I had a mother blessing that my doulas put on for me and brought my friends together and felt very supported. I did decide to continue breastfeeding throughout my pregnancy because my friend that is an IBCLC had recommended that I not try to wean in pregnancy, that that might cause my body some stress. And my daughter did not want to wean, so I didn't force it.
Wow, that's so interesting.
Yeah.
How was the birth?
It was amazing. I did a lot of visualization about how I wanted things to go. And so I had wanted to deliver during the day. I ended up going 2 days over my due date, and my son was actually born on Halloween. So yeah, it was great. So I labored at home.
Was the hospital decorated for Halloween?
It was, yeah. It was so fun.
So fun.
It was, yeah. So I remember making my daughter breakfast, having some surges, and just going about my day. And because I had a child to care for, it was a great distraction. And so I called my doulas and my parents came and picked my daughter up, and we headed into the hospital. And I remember getting checked at triage, and I had a bulging bag of water. So I was about 6.5 to 7, and my water broke right when I got up to my room. So I was pushing, and a resident ran in, and my OB was in by about the second push. And again, very similar to the first, I only had a handful of pushes. So I think it was about 4 with my son.
Wow. I think I pushed more when our kids were born than you did.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Actually, it's sort of true, though. It's, you know, sometimes you feed your toddlers, and I don't know, for me anyway, when I hold the spoon in front of their face, I always open up my mouth. just subconsciously. I like hold the spoon. I'm like, pop, pop, every time. Also, I think when my wife was pushing, and even as a doula, when my clients were pushing, I definitely found myself also pushing sometimes. And then I'd be sore the next day. Anyway, enough about me. So after the birth, did the baby have any of the regulatory issues?
Nothing at all. So he was almost 9 pounds. I felt like he had rolls compared to my daughter, and he was easy as far as that first latch, and I was able to room in with him. The only hiccup is we didn't have many postpartum doulas in our area. I knew what they were at that time, but my husband had to go home to care for my daughter. So I was alone in the hospital, which was a little bit challenging, but the nurses were amazing. And the only issue with him is I was having some uncomfortable latches, and the pediatrician discovered a tongue tie once I got home and went to the first visit and was complaining about the difference between the two in feeding. And so he got that revised, and everything was fine after that.
Awesome. I want to take another break. When we come back, I want to talk a little bit more about your work and your book, and draw some more of your amazing pearls of wisdom. We'll be right back. Welcome back. We're talking to Kristin Revere. Okay, let's talk about this book. It's a relatively new book at this point. What made you want to write a book on top of all the other things that you were doing?
Well, as a former journalism major, I've always wanted to write a book to start with, and really felt like even having the online course, the information that I've learned over the years and that my co-author, Alyssa Venaclaus, who's a sleep consultant, which I am not, we wanted to be able to reach more people and be even more accessible than all of our classes and courses would allow.
And what's the structure of the book?
So it is divided into 2 parts, and I wrote the pregnancy and birth preparation section, and then Alyssa wrote the baby care and postnatal preparation section, which does include feeding of all types and sleep for both parents as well as infants.
When do you recommend people read the book?
Early in pregnancy or even preconception if they are planning a family.
So someone like you who's a planner.
Yes.
But I do think so. I think it's great that even if you're thinking about it, to read this book before the pregnancy is how you can get the most out of it.
Exactly. And then it's also great for anyone who works with expecting families or new parents, and includes a lot of resources like Webster certified chiropractors, mental health therapists, pelvic floor physical therapists, car seat safety technicians, and everything from streaming platforms like Informed Pregnancy Plus to documentaries to books and ways to, you know, expand your education again for those that are planners or who want more evidence-based research.
Yeah, it's a great resource by itself, and it's also a guide to other great resources. So it's got a lot of value there, and you can get a lot of information over a short period of time. And the book is called Supported, Your Guide to Birth and Baby. If someone is towards the beginning of a pregnancy, from your online resources, where would somebody want to start?
Early in pregnancy, certainly deciding where they want to give birth, which we cover in the book, their dream team of not only their OB-GYN or nurse midwife or home birth midwife, but everyone else that they want to assemble. And that could be a physical therapist or a chiropractor, thinking about childcare. I mean, we're in a childcare crisis right now. One of the earliest things that I tell my doula clients to do is plan for childcare, find a nanny or au pair or a center, and look into childbirth education if they choose to prepare in that way. Hire a doula early and check out their maternity benefits, because a lot of the dream team members, like a physical therapist, a chiropractor, may be covered under benefits. And I'm so thankful that birth and postpartum doulas are covered in many corporate benefits now with plans like Carrot Fertility and Progeny.
Yeah, that's a great point. And I do think, you know, we talk all the time about how it takes a village to raise a child, and to some degree, the village that was there not too long ago is gone. And as you're talking about all these different professions and professionals, they're really there to fill in the gaps where the village is not there anymore, and to provide the kind of support during fertility, early pregnancy, late pregnancy, birth, postpartum, and raising a child, to kind of fill in and give the support that was once there and is pretty much still needed.
Right.
And without that support, it just becomes much more challenging on the mind, body, spirit couple. And so all the things that you're talking about, I think that a lot of people don't realize, A, that they might need, and B, that are available.
Exactly.
Sometimes until it's too late. Like in your case, even not having had a doula with your first baby.
Right. I certainly could have used doulas. And I think that you mentioned, again, there's the lack of the village. People are moving for jobs and may not have family nearby, or they're delaying pregnancy and they have aging parents that they're also caring for that can't necessarily help with childcare. And so there are so many different concerns now, or even at Gold Coast, we teach a grandparents class, and so much has changed with feeding and safe sleep and car seats that we want to take the pressure off of our clients and give the grandparents some evidence-based information and keep them up to date on how to safely care for their grandkids.
It's another great resource. Okay, so you have all these wonderful resources. Where can we find them online?
So goldcoastdoulas.com is my agency website. And then the book website is supportedbook.com. And I'm on Facebook and Instagram and Pinterest at Gold Coast Doulas.
Awesome. Kristin, thank you so much for joining me today, and also for all of the incredible work that you're doing that is available, again, to the lucky people in your area in Michigan, but really to anybody anywhere through the book and through your online offerings. It's really a tremendous support to the community, and it's certainly helping a lot of people have a better experience and a better transition to parenthood. So thank you.
Thank you. And again, I appreciate your contribution to the foreword of the book.
Could not be more honored. And at home, thanks for listening to the Informed Pregnancy Podcast. For more pregnancy and parenting information just like this, visit us online at informedpregnancy.com.